For many of you, I really don't need to introduce Eric Niebler. He's been active in Boost since the earliest days. He's a on the steering committee. He's a release manager. He's the developer and maintainer of several Boost libraries. He's been a presenter here a number of times. But today he's wearing a different hat. He's also been a longtime contributor and member of the ISO C++ Standards Committee. While he's helped out there in many areas, he's a library guy, as you would expect. And he's leading one of the efforts that's going on right now. The only thing I'm going to say is when he's talking, this is not some outsider. This is the horse's mouth. Okay. This is the person doing the work. This is the person that all the committee members are, you know, staring at. Because ISO CPP, the foundation, has started a grant making process, and Eric's an independent consultant, and so he was one of our first grant recipients. He's doing his job, and so let's welcome Eric Niebler.
Wow, great. Thanks, guys. I've been coming to BoostCon, CPP now, ever since it existed. So it's been, I don't know, almost 10 years now. This is the ninth year. Finally getting a chance to keynote. I'm super excited to be here. I'm also really excited about the topic, what I'm going to be talking about. I've been working on a Rains library for about a year and a half now, but very few people know I've actually been working on Ranges off and on for the better part of 10 years. A very long time ago, I had a Range library and started playing around with some of these ideas. Some of those ideas eventually made it into Boost Range. But this is a whole new project. And this project has kind of gotten legs. And it's actually turning into an effort to rewrite the standard library. What we're going to be talking about is ranges and concepts, mostly ranges, and how it all fits together, and what my vision for the future of the C++ standard library is. I'm going to be talking about what they're good for, what parts make up all of ranges, and how they play together, and why you should care, and where are we in the standardization process? Because I think that's what everybody really cares about. So this talk is actually going to be all code. It's going to be one big long example that I'm going to work through. I've never given a talk like this before. I have no idea how this is going to go. But I got the idea from this talk from a strange place, the D community actually, because ranges are really popular in the D community. And there's this article on the D Wiki, Component Programming with Ranges, talking about how great ranges are and look how great they are at solving this one particular problem. Not too many years ago, this stage was occupied by a fellow named Andrei Alexandrescu. Maybe some guys, some of you know him. He was talking about how iterators had to go. I was talking about how great D ranges are and how much better ranges are than iterators and how we can do away with iterators entirely. So I had great pleasure to implement the solution that was here in C++ with ranges. And my solution is about half as many lines of code as the D solution. So with all due respect to Andre, I'll say iterators can stay. Okay, so here is the problem that we're going to be solving. We're going to be writing a calendar out to the console. Okay. This is not the most useful program I've ever written in my life. In fact, it could be the most useless, but it is useful in one regard. The implementation of the code that does this, it kind of spans the entire range of ranges. Every feature that's in the range library that I intend to propose to the C++ standard is used in the implementation of this example. Some things to note about this, the output here. Can everybody see it all right? Yeah? Okay. So you'll notice we got months side by side. Sometimes the months, obviously, they don't always begin on Sunday. You'll notice that we're going to be generating dates. If we generate dates, you know, in date order, we don't actually print the dates out to the console in the same order in which we're going to be generating them. So there's going to be some sort of an impedance mismatch there. So all sorts of interesting niggles. February, it takes only 4 lines. May takes 6 lines. So there's all these weird things, dates and times. These are these squalid human systems that are ugly. And so it's going to be hard, one would might imagine, to write beautiful code that has to deal with ugly systems like dates and times. Okay. Here's the solution. Can everybody read that? Yeah? Thank you. Okay. Like I said, about 150 lines of code. The D solution was about 300. And so we're going to go through this line at a time. And by the end, we're going to have a nice, tidy, mathematical solution to this problem. Okay. Step one. Should be easy enough. We want to create a range of dates. So we're going to use the date time library from Boost. Who here has used the date time library? You could keep your hand down, Jeff. Yeah. Who would like to see Jeff finish version 2 and submit it to the standardization committee?
No pressure.
Yeah. All right. Get on that. Okay. So here we create a date. November 5th, 1955. We print it out. There we go. Who knows the significance of that date?
So I think it's the day when Back to the Future he arrives back in the...
Right, it's the date that Doc invents the flux capacitor. That's right. Okay. Very auspicious date. Okay, so now let's create a range. And obviously ranges aren't standard yet, so I'm gonna be using my range v3 library, which you can find on GitHub right here. So we can include all of ranges, import the namespace, and I can use what I call a view adapter or a generator here called iota. And I say the integers 1, using 11 as the upper bound. Okay, just print out all of those integers. And that does that. Okay. So here, notice that all of the ranges in the library are streamable. This is really handy for debugging. That's the format that you get. If you don't like it, you could write your own stream operator. Okay. So, ranges, what is this thing here? So it looks a little bit like a container, but it's not really. It's got a begin and an end, and begin returns an iterator. You could iterate through the elements. In this case, though, the elements are being actually generated on the fly. And that's really common when you're dealing with range libraries. Data is going to be generated for you on the fly. Okay, so we got begin and end members. They return iterator sentinel pairs. Not iterator-iterator pairs. This is slightly different than what you're used to. I'm not going to really be digging into the guts of dates and the design, I mean the range library and the design of it. Mostly in this talk, I'll be dealing with the usage. But just, you know, keep this in your back pocket. Sentinels are things that are comparable to iterators. They might not themselves be full-blown iterators. They're lazy sequence algorithms. And this is an important philosophical point. Although a range might look like a container, it's got begin and end, it's probably closer to an algorithm that's turned inside out. It is. You're going to pull an iterator out of this thing. You're going to dereference that, and it's going to execute some code and give you a value. Then you're going to increment it, and that's going to advance your algorithm. But when you're incrementing, you are pulling data out, so it's a pull model for computation. These are necessarily lightweight and non-owning things. Ranges don't own their values. They differ from containers, which do. They're composable, so we can chain adapters of views and create complicated computations declaratively, just a single line of code. And they are all non-mutating. So if I create a view that adapts a container by applying a transformation to it, it's not actually going to be changing the container, it's just going to be applying that transformation function on the fly. Okay, so we've got dates, we've got this handy iota view which counts things, so why don't we use the view iota and say the from date and the to date. Who thinks this is going to work? Yeah, unfortunately not so much. We get this nice error. The object passed to view iota must model the weakly incrementable concept. That is, it must have pre and post increment operators, and it must have a difference type. So it's good news and bad news. The good news is we got a great error. We know exactly what the problem is. The bad news is it doesn't work. So the funny thing about dates, I can take two dates, I can subtract them, and I can get a count of days between those dates. But I can't increment dates, which seems really strange to me. I asked Jeff about it. He's like, yeah, I don't know what I was thinking. Sorry about that. It's fixed in 2.0, so I trust him. Okay, so this is something that we should work around in our code. So I just defined the increment operators myself. You know, it's not very nice to go reaching into Boost's namespace and adding overloads and whatnot, but for expedience, I went ahead and did that. I also defined the difference type of date to be this ugly thing, which I think is as close as I could get to what the difference type should be for dates. And now I could use this handy macro, concept assert, that dates are incrementable. Okay, great. That's all that the iota view cares about. So now I can say view iota from to, passing it dates. I could take the first 10, this is another range view adapter, and I can print them out to the console, and I get the first 10 dates of the year. Okay? All right. Notice how these things compose. I'm going to use this guy, the pipe operator, to chain operations. Okay. So don't do that. Fortunately, you won't have to when Jeff finishes version 2.0. Yeah. Okay. Next step is going to be grouping the dates into months. Yeah, question.
Yeah, why did you have to use ranges for instead of just ranges?
Ah, right. Thank you for catching me on that one. So remember how I said that begin-end returns iterator sentinel pairs? The thing about iterators and sentinels is that they don't have the same type.
Yeah, why not?
Why don't they have the same type? Why did I make that design decision? Yeah, it would be nice. There's actually a way that you could use range for. The question was why not make it so that begin and end have the same type, and that way things work with range 4. Well, I considered that kind of a compromising the design. I have this idea for how things should be, and I kind of want them to be in a certain way. And so compromising the design to accommodate what I see as a limitation in the language is not what I wanted. I really want to push for change. So I think the beginning and the end should be allowed to have different types for various reasons, namely being simplicity of implementation of these things, better code generation in many cases, the ability to represent a wider range of things that can represent ranges. For instance, in addition to two positions, that's what a range is today. Why can't we have a range that is a position and a count of elements? Right? That should be a range, you know? Why can't a range be a position and a predicate that tells you when you've reached the end? That should be a range too, right? So it's just a little bit more, it's a more general formulation to allow iterators and sentinels to have different types. As long as they are comparable, that's all that should matter. Yeah, question?
Why do you need the difference type in there as opposed to just using the type returned by subtraction operator?
Why does the range library need a difference type instead of just automatically figuring out what the difference type is by subtracting things? Well, that's a good question, but not all types are subtractable, right? So incrementable, the only thing that that is required for an incrementable type is that I can increment it, right? And that I can count the number of increments using something like a difference type. Just because I can increment something doesn't mean I can subtract them and find the difference. For instance, consider like input iterators. This is an incrementable type, but you can't subtract input iterators to find the distance between them. Okay? You kind of have to tell the library what the difference type of an input iterator is. We use iterator traits for that today. This is just a different way of doing it. Did I answer your question? Okay. Any other questions? Cool. Okay. So grouping grouping dates into months. Now what I mean by grouping here is right now we have a range of dates. I want to turn it into a range of ranges of dates, where the ranges of dates are the months. Okay. And we could do that using this group by view adapter. So starting at the top, we have a function that given a year returns a view that has all of the dates in that year. And then we get all the dates in 2015, and we group them, and we pass a predicate to group by. It takes two objects and returns true or false, depending on whether they belong in the same group or not. And now I can iterate over the months in the year, and this is going to be a range of dates. A month is now a range of dates, so that I could pull out the first month, the first day of the month, and print it. And if I do that, I get the first day of each month, January, February, March, April, May. Group by is pretty handy. Yeah. Be using that one again. The months are already in order. The question was, how did it know to put the months in order? So it requires the elements to be adjacent when you're grouping stuff. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. So just for the sake of readability, let's pull that group by adapter out, that groups by months, and we'll call it by month. And now we can use it over here. That's a lot cleaner. That's just a reorg and a cleanup. These things, by the way, automatic return types, that's really handy. And so like taking these complicated expressions, giving them a name, and using automatic return type deduction is something that we're going to be using a lot. OK? So So these are the range views that come out of the box with range V3. I don't know which of these I'm planning on proposing yet. This is quite a collection. But these are really powerful tools that you can use to just snap together to build solutions. And they're all perfectly general. Yeah?
What's the difference between take and take exactly?
So the question was, what's the difference between take and take exactly? What happens if you take 10 elements out of a range that has 5 elements? You get 5 elements, right? So that means that when you say take of a range, you don't know how big that range actually is, right? Sometimes it's really handy for that thing to know its size. It enables certain optimizations. So if you have a range that has 100 elements and you want to take 10 elements out of it, so you know you have enough elements, you can use take exactly, and that's a promise. Like, I promise that there's really 10 elements in this range. So it's okay for this range object to advertise itself as a sized range. It knows its size. Question?
What happens if the bigger
What happens if you use take exactly and you've lied? Oops. Yeah, don't do that. Yeah. Okay. Now we're going to use the same trick again. We've got months, now we want weeks. We're going to use group by again. We create this guy. Looks awfully familiar. We use group by. There's this little snag here. We use week number, but we have to increment both sides first before we do the comparison, because week number reports weeks as Monday through Sunday, and we want Sunday through Saturday.
You have the US at least.
Yes.
In Germany, it's different.
In Germany, you want Monday through Sunday?
Yes.
Ah, okay. Well, that's not the application I'm building. Localization is not my strong point. Yeah. And there's one other snag. Since we already have things in months, when we want to transform months into weeks, we have to reach into each month and apply the transformation to each month. And so we can use view transform for doing that. It iterates over all of the elements in the range and applies a transformation to them. So for every month in the year, carve it up into weeks. So this is getting really interesting here. We start with a range of dates. We go by month and we turn it into a range of ranges of dates. And then we carve it up into weeks and we end up with a range of ranges of ranges of dates. But we could iterate over the months and then iterate over the weeks, and then we can display each week, applying a transformation to each day. Just give me the day part of the date, throwing away the year and the month. And just print that out, okay? And this is what we get. Well, this is pretty interesting. I mean, we've done hardly any work at all, and this is already starting to look like a calendar. Cool. Formatting. I hate formatting. Fortunately, Boost has a library for it. It's called Boost Format. It doesn't perform particularly well, but it is really handy. So let's use it to simplify our lives. Starting at the top, we got a format day. So it takes a date, and it prints just the day part in a field that's 3 characters wide. That's all that magic syntax does. And now I'm starting to get a little lost in my ranges of ranges and ranges. So I'm adding comments here. Format weeks is going to take a range of dates, which is a month grouped into weeks. And I'm going to output a range of strings, which is a month with formatted weeks. And it's a transform, so I'm going to be transforming each week, which, remember, is a range of dates. And the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to print out some white space. So here, percent one grabs this first item and writes it out. The first item is going to be, give me the first day of the week. Tell me what day of the week it is, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. Times it by three, that's how many spaces this guy gets. Turn it into a string. This is just padding. Okay. And then, for the week, I want to transform each day by formatting the day, which we saw up there, and then join. I'm going to come back to this guy. What join does, it's going to take all of these strings that were printed out by format day, and it's going to glom them all together into one big formatted week. All right. Now I can transform the month by formatting, by carving it into weeks and then formatting each week. And now, let me talk a little bit about actions. Remember I said that we're going to be glomming together all the strings over here? Well, this isn't really a range operation, because like I said, range operations are lazy. Oh yeah, question, Alan. So transform applies this function, yes, to each element. So here's a function. So we're going to be iterating over the months in a year, and then apply this function to each element on the fly, lazily.
Do for all.
Do for all. Yes. Okay. So we transform the weeks, and then we glom together all of the strings. So like I said, this is not really a view. Because if you are creating a view of some joined together strings, what you end up with is a lazy range of characters. But what does Boost Format know about lazy ranges of characters? Nothing at all. It wants a string. So we actually have to do something eagerly for a change. Everything else to this point has been completely lazy. But this, we need something that happens immediately. For that, we use actions. So an action actually does the thing. So as opposed to views, this is an eager sequence algorithm. It can operate on and return containers. It's composable and potentially mutating. So it can actually change the container underneath it. Here's how they line up with views. I said views are lazy. These are eager. Views are lightweight and non-owning. These can operate on return containers. They're both composable, but only range actions can mutate their underlying data. And they play together really nicely with the views. Here are some of the built-in actions. Some of these are the same as the views, like drop. You could certainly drop elements out of a container. That makes sense. It makes sense to do it lazily. It also makes sense to do it eagerly. Some of these things are very container-like. Push back, push front. Sort is something that's very interesting. Have you ever wanted to like read a bunch of data into a temporary vector, then pipe it to a sort, and then pipe it to unique? Yeah. Sure, that seems like a reasonable thing to do. So there's sort, there's unique. Boom. Question in the back?
So, in the past, when I have needed to sort and unique, first column sort and then column unique, does an extra pass over the data?
Yes. So the question is, does this make multiple passes over the data? And that's another important difference between views and actions, which I failed to mention. Thank you for bringing that up. If you create a complicated pipeline of view adapters, when you execute it, it's only going to make a single pass over the data, which is important. But with these actions, since they're eager, it needs to actually retraverse the same data. Robert.
I'm intrigued with the sort for a couple of reasons. I like the whole scheme where nothing gets done until it has to be, and nothing gets mutated. I see that there's a lot of appeal. And sort's very interesting, as I see the possibility of implementing that either in the lazy way or the eager way. And so I'm wondering, do you have for the views, do they have their own sort, or is that not implemented, or is there a reason that I'm missing and that's not implementable when I think it should be?
So the question is, like, how come there isn't a sort view that doesn't mutate the underlying sequence?
For sort.
And the answer is, I just don't know how to do it. How do you sort a sequence of elements without storing something somewhere and sorting it there, or mutating it in place?
Well, that's the thing. I can envision a situation where it's stored in a temporary area which exists only while that sequence is being processed. And it, so that the underlying sequence itself is not mutated, but we're still accessing the elements through this temporary array of references to the original underlying thing. So I'm curious if you've been willing to subject yourself to that layer level of pain to get something like that. Or maybe that's something, or maybe it's really not possible. I'm kind of just suffering from wishful thinking.
Okay, so the question is, well, couldn't a view just like create a scratch base and do the sort there? It certainly could, but I feel like it kind of confuses the difference between a view and a container. Views, it's very nice to deal with them because you know that they are lightweight and non-owning. You can copy them around freely and return them from functions. When you get around to like owning scratch space, these things start to become heavy, and they start to own resources. And copying them around, right, you no longer know what the semantics of it. Is it actually going to be copying elements now when I copy the view? So I didn't want to go there. I want to keep the model simple and pure. Yeah. Question?
How do I know when an action is acting on the underlying container or on its own copy?
So were you asking in relation to Robert's question?
Yeah, somehow. So if the view doesn't do anything but do a slice, then how do I know the action acts on the real container or does its own copy?
Oh, so the question was, you know, if you have a view that is a slice, and then I operate on that with an action?
Yeah.
Okay. So if you have a slice, then you have, say, a slice of a container. So there is real data there that can be mutated. And then you pass that to an action. What you're saying is, go ahead and mutate that data. So it's helpful to keep these two notions separate. You have views, which are like windows into data that lives elsewhere, and actions, which are allowed to actually apply changes to that data. So if you don't want to write changes through to your underlying data, an action is not the right thing for you, or what you should do is copy it into a separate container and apply the action there.
So one could just say, if you don't want mutability, just use views. If you're going to use an action, you're going to get it.
Right. So if you don't want anything to be mutated, just use a view. Richard.
One of the things about up, so if unique is actually modifying the underlying container, one of the things about, I think it was erase and remove, is sort of the algorithm doesn't really know about the container type, so it really can't change the container type. Does this mean like the action like unique needs to know about the underlying container type in order to remove things? So if you had a vector, it actually maintains sort of the
right. Right. So the observation was some of these actions are definitely changing not just the elements of the container, but actually the size of the container, adding and removing elements. So how does that work? And it works by you define a concept. There is a concept like an insertable sequence and an erasable sequence, and there are customization points that says, okay, here is how you generically insert elements into a sequence. And if my container wants to hook this, right, you define that customization point, right? This is how I insert and remove elements from my container. Wow, questions. Yeah, John.
So I'm to only give you a specific scenario. Suppose I have vector ints, and then I'm using a view to transform them to strings. Maybe I spell out the name of the int, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I use an action to transform them to capitalize the string. But that's not going back to the original data, obviously, because I can't capitalize my ints. How do I look at something and know the action is operating on the view that immediately preceded it or back on the original data?
So
completely off on.
Right. So the question was, okay, I have a view that is generating strings on the fly, right? And I want to send that to an action that capitalizes those. Well, I would say an action is not the right choice for that. What you want to use is the transform view to read in a string, uppercase it, and return the new string on the fly.
Would I get a compiler?
Would you get a compiler? No, you would not get a compiler, because you can read in a temporary string, you can mutate it, and you could write it back out by value, and that's not a problem. Right, so move semantics takes care of a lot of the performance problems here.
The question was, is if you didn't use a view transform, but you used an action transform on the result of a view, would you get a compiler?
If you used the action transform on data that could not be mutated, would you get a compiler error? Yes, you would. Pretty sure. Yeah. Okay, I see lots of hands. There's tons of material to get to, and I really want to kind of move it along. So, like, quick questions?
Where's reverse?
Where's reverse? I don't have a reverse action. That's a good point. Let's see. Where do I have? Here, let's see. There better be a reverse here. There, okay. Phew! Yeah, I can lazily reverse. I just haven't written the action to actually do it eagerly yet. Yes, question?
Why is there not a sorted action?
A sorted action? It's called sort. I don't know. We could argue about names, but I don't really want to bike.
As far as I can figure out, sort actually changes the underlying container, whereas sorted does not. It reifies it on the fly and has a copy.
Okay, so sorted would do something different. It would do the sort on the fly and store it in a copy.
Yes. You could sort the transform, like a view transform, basically. You have a bunch of transforms, and then you just sort it. And after that, you've got a.
Well, that was the question that Robert asked. So if you want to sort views, then things get ugly. My best advice to you would be to use the view, generate the data on the fly, use it to initialize a container, then do the sort in the container. Yeah?
So I think for this use case, it would be nice to have a collect action.
A collect action.
So within the pipeline, it can do action collect, and pass it, say, the vector, say, collect the current view into an actual vector. And then I can proceed on this.
Okay, so the question was, something that you could put in your pipeline that actually turns it into a vector, then you could keep applying more transformations. And there's actually a problem with doing that. Views, logically, are windows into data that live elsewhere. If the data that lives elsewhere is a temporary object that is going to go away, what is the semantics of that? It's a real problem. So in order to prevent you from shooting yourself in the foot like this, you cannot apply a view to a temporary container. You have to actually use the view to initialize a container, give it a name and a lifetime, and then you can continue applying views to it. Okay, I'm gonna get going. Okay, so far so good, right? Back to our example. We can create a year, carve it up by months, we could lay out the months, and now I get strings for each week, and I could print them out. Boom. Well, this is looking really great. Feeling like we're almost there already, but we're not. Some things to note. We don't have month titles, so let's deal with the month titles next. So here's a function that takes a date and returns a month title. That's been formatted in a field that's 22 characters wide, and it's been centered. That's what this like wonky syntax means. Okay, and the date time library gives us this really handy function that gives us the name of the month. Okay? And now, this was our layout months function from before. Here's, remember, where we were calling format weeks. And now we've changed it up a little bit. We can grab our month title, and we can turn it into a range by saying view single. That creates a range of exactly one element. And we can use view concat to concatenate this range and that range. Now we return that instead. Okay? Wow, getting a sense for how these ranges are powerful and how they compose together to create complex behaviors from the parts that snap together. Now we get month titles. That was pretty easy. Okay, padding. Let's look at this again. Remember I said February only takes 4 lines, January takes 5, right? We're gonna be displaying these things side by side, right? So they really ought to occupy the same amount of vertical space. So we have to add some padding lines. Let's make this just a little bit more complicated. The first thing that we need to do is we need to figure out how much vertical space is the month currently taking up. So we could do that by carving it up into weeks and counting the number of weeks. Store that off in distance. And now we build a padded string. And we use repeat n to create a view that repeats that padding a certain number of times. Question?
You have 6 hard-coded. Is there any way to figure that out, looking at the entire range to see what the max is?
Ah, right. So the question is, 6 is a magic number. There's lots of magic numbers all over here. Yeah. Sorry about that. Is there any way to actually infer that from the actual data that's being generated? And you certainly could. It would take more code. That's all. Another question? Oh, okay. Right. So great. Now we get our padding. 1 line of padding for January, 2 lines of padding for February, and so on. Okay. So what do you guys think so far? You know, we've done a whole lot of work just snapping together bits that came out of the box from the range library. We've written very little code. And notice that, like, in our solution here, so far there have been no raw loops, no conditionals, and there's one other thing, I can't remember. Yeah. No iterators, right? It's kind of interesting. All of this works because of iterators, and we haven't seen a single one. Cool. So this is where we are right now. These things are totally reusable. And the other cool thing is, if our range of input dates is infinite, this still works. We got that for free. Pretty neat. Okay. Things get interesting now, though. Displaying months side by side is actually a really tricky problem. And it required an awful lot of thought. It feels like we should be done, but we're not quite. So notice that we transition from this, like, because the console is linear access, I don't get random access to my console, I have to rearrange my data or generate it in a different way in order to write things out to the console in a way that makes sense. Okay. But this looks a little bit more complicated than it really is. Let's simplify it just a little bit. We generate a range of months, and each month is a range of strings. That's kind of like a matrix, right? And we want to translate it into something that looks more like this, where we have 3 months side by side. So can anybody describe in words the transformation that needs to happen to the data to get from the left-hand side to the right-hand side? Yeah? What's that? It's a transposition of the matrix.
First the split.
First you split, and then you transpose, right? So we grab 3 months at a time, we transpose the rows and the columns, and then we glue that all back together again. So that's what we're going to be doing. You guys got that right away. That actually took me quite a while. Yeah. All right. So you guys called it. We chunk into groups of three. We transpose. We join the chunks. And then we're going to join the strings of the inner ranges. That is, glom together the strings that make up the line. Print. Take the rest of the day off.
Picnic.
Woot. Yeah. Okay. So far, we've just been using the bits and pieces that the range library has given us. I got to this point in the implementation, and I was like, darn, I don't actually have something that groups things into groups of threes, or fours, or fives. So I had to implement it. So now we're going to actually get to the part of the talk where we create new range types. Okay. We're going to create a chunk view that takes a range and carves it up into a range of ranges. All right. And we better have a forward iterable so I can assert that here. Okay. Now I'm going to need n, which is the number of elements in each chunk. And I'm going to inherit from this type called range adapter. Yeah, question.
Yeah, I just wonder whether you could fake this chunk view as a group by with a stateful comparison.
Ah, okay. So the question was, could I fake a chunk view as group by with a stateful comparison? You can, but it's actually tricky, and it wouldn't work the way you think it would. The unfortunate thing about group by is that it actually traverses the sequence twice. And that's just the nature of the problem. One is like when you actually are traversing the group, and the other is when you increment the outer group to find the next element. Yeah. So you actually have to, yeah. A stateful predicate passed to group by is let's not go there. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so range adapter is going to reach inside our chunk view, and it's going to look for this function, begin adapter. Okay, and it's going to return one of these guys, which I am not showing you just yet. And the rest of this is all just boilerplate. Okay, so let's take a look at adapter. Put that over there for now. Okay, here we got the number of elements in a chunk. Here we've got the end of the total range. Okay, and here is our adapter. Think about how a chunk view should work, right? Instead of just like giving you each element one at a time, when you dereference a chunk view's iterator, what you want is a range of three elements. Well, we can use the take view for that. We already know how to do that. So given an iterator, we turn it into a range using the current iterator and the end iterator, and we pass that to the take view along with n. Give me the next three elements. Okay. And then we can change the behavior of increment by hopping over three elements. And this is a bounded advance because we don't want to go past the end. There might not be a multiple of three elements in our range. That's all there is to it. Now we've just created chunk view. Yeah?
Why does this contain it using base frequency?
So why did I make this private?
It's made private.
Yeah, make it private because, well, previous, since I inherit from this adapter base, I'm going to get a whole bunch of default behaviors. And some of them are going to be wrong. And I don't want to have to implement previous because my problem doesn't need it. A general solution would, like, there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to iterate a chunk view in reverse, right? But we don't need it, so make it private. That default implementation is going to be wrong anyway. That's it.
So did you suggest the standard call language that you can use equally leave there?
Did I suggest to the
call language that we add the feature to say I can write there equals delete?
So I think I can. I think I could say equals delete, couldn't I? I'm not sure, actually.
But you could spam out all the signatures and delete them.
Yeah, I would have to spam out signatures and delete them, and I don't really want to do that.
You just need one signature, because all others then are hidden.
Would all of the other signatures would be then be hidden? Yeah. So I mean, I could define the signature and say equals delete, and that would have the same effect. I thought this was, you know, I'm taking lazy route. Yeah. Okay. So the other thing that we need, so chunk view is this class, and what I want are these adapters that I can use in this like adapter pipeline thing. So I need some pipeable thing, maybe call it chunk. Right? So here's a function, it takes an integer, and it returns a pipeable thing. Right, you can kind of think of pipe as just a different syntax for a unary function. Okay? So you can turn a unary function into a pipeable thing with make pipeable. And it's going to take a range, and it's going to create a chunk view that adapts that range. And I do a funny dance here by pulling out all the elements of the range. Here, view all returns all the elements of a range. Now, if you already have a range, it's just going to return that range. But if this were actually a container, we wouldn't want to copy the container. We want to reference all of the elements. So that's what view all is for.
Does it work on infinite ranges?
Would it work on infinite ranges? For sure it would. Because it's not an eager thing, right? You're just going to be taking that infinite range and returning it. The infinite range is not a container, right? There are no infinite containers. Yeah. And here's how we use it. I can create a vector, 10 elements. I can chunk it into chunks of 3, and that's the output I get. Chunked. Everybody get that? We created our own range view from scratch, and it wasn't that hard. Yeah?
So I come up with a way you could actually do it just by composing existing pieces, which is generate a, basically a repeat of 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 3, 3, 2, 2, 2, sip it with the range you want to chunk, then do it proper group by on the second element of the pair, and then transform and just pick the first L again.
I'm not going to repeat that. You're talking about how to do the entire how to do a transpose?
The chunking? Not writing your own view, but instead composing pieces of existing view.
Oh. All right, you can show me later. Yeah, but then it wouldn't show. I wouldn't get a chance to show how to use view adapter, which is kind of handy. Yeah. Okay. Transposing ranges of ranges. You know, if this were just a matrix that had random access and could be mutated in place, this would be really easy, right? But a range of ranges how to lazily transpose a range of ranges where each row is being generated on demand, and each element of each column is being generated on demand, and you only have forward access to any of them. Right? And you can't mutate it in place, because you can't. There is none, no mutation, and there's no elements to mutate. So what we need to do is we need to write some clever traversal that makes this range of ranges look like it's transposed. Can anybody think of a way of doing that?
A range of views?
A range of views. Yeah. Yeah, but that's, I mean, you're getting there, but that's not not half the story. Yeah, someone has to write the views, and you have to figure out how to do the traversal. I mean, it's not easy, right? So this part really made me feel stupid for a really long time. And this is, you know, one of the bad things about ranges, is that sometimes you get these stumpers, and you just don't know how to achieve the traversal that you want. After about a day of messing with this, I had a really nice thought. And here is how you do it. So you have three rows with these columns in them. What you can do is the first thing you do is you do this sort of an interleave traversal. All right? So what you do is you've got this structure, you want to erase the structure, and you want to do it in a certain way by visiting elements in a round-robin fashion. So you flatten things out, and you get a flat range of elements like that, okay? And then you chunk it. And that's how you transpose a range of ranges. The funny thing is, these rows themselves could be infinite, and I can still transpose it. All right. So the other good thing about that, we've already got this part, chunk. We can reuse it. We just have to write interleave. The question is, they have to be equally long. Yes. Yeah, for interleave to work, they have to be equally long, or you have to figure out what you would do for unequal ranges. Yeah. But in our case, the ranges are going to be equal length, so we don't care. We've made them equal length. Okay. Here's the interleave view. And instead of using range adapter to adapt an existing range, we're going to be using range facade. Range facade is for creating a new range from scratch, rather than adapting an existing range. So it's going to be parameterized on ranges, that is a matrix, a bunch of rows and columns. And so when I take the value of that, the value type is going to be the type of the row, that is the month. Okay. So I'm going to have a vector of the months. Now, this isn't really allocating a whole lot of memory, because the months themselves are lazily generated data structures. So this vector is going to have three elements in it, and it's going to hold three ranges that generate the elements of the week. Okay. So just like with range adapter, it's going to look for an object. Oops, sorry about that. It's going to be looking for this function in here called cursor. Cursor is going to say how to do the traversal. And it's going to build an iterator out of the cursor. So you could think of a cursor as like a mini iterator. It just has a really stripped down interface so that we don't have to implement the full-blown iterator interface. Has anybody used Boost Iterators library? Yeah, wow, geez, a lot of people. So I actually stole the code right out of the Boost Iterators library. Okay. So here's the cursor. We've got a pointer back to that vector of ranges. And now we've got a vector of iterators into those ranges up there. And now we implement a bunch of member functions, current, next, done, and equal. And that's all we need to do to implement our interleave view. Current is really simple. We take some index into that vector of iterators. We dereference that iterator. That's going to be our first element. Next, we increment that iterator, mod it. If it's zero, bump all the iterators forward one. Okay? We are done when n is zero and at least one iterator has reached the end of its owning range. And I use the mismatch algorithm for that. Notice these algorithms here. I'm not passing iterators to the algorithms, I'm passing ranges to the algorithms. Because the range library provides range-based overloads of all of standard algorithms. Question?
So that's the code that initializes
those. Right. So this is an aggregate, so I don't need a constructor. Instead, I just initialize it like this. So I start at zero, I pass it a pointer to the range of to the vector of ranges, and then I pass in this initial range, which is all of the begin iterators. Interesting to note, this is a range that generates iterators lazily, and I use it to initialize a vector. Ranges convert to containers. Okay.
So there's a conversion operator.
Say it again?
Is there a conversion operator?
There's an implicit conversion operator from all range types to container types as long as the types match. Yeah. Jeff?
What drives your decision on what things to store in the cursor and what things to store in the current class?
So the question is, how do you know what to store in the range and what to store in the cursor? And the answer is, store as little in the cursor as possible. You're going to be building iterators out of these things. Iterators get copied a lot, and you want copies to be as cheap as possible. This is a fairly heavyweight iterator because it has a vector. It's got dynamically allocated memory. Now, I didn't have to make it as general as all of this. We know that n is going to be 3 here, so I don't really need a vector. I could use an array. But I like to make my solutions as general as possible, within reason. So I went with a vector here. Yeah, question? Do I need the mod in here? I do need the mod because I need this guy to go back down to zero somehow.
Yeah, but it's always in the range of zero to the size minus one, right?
Right.
So you could just check if it is size minus one or whatever, or increment it and check the zero size and then set it to zero.
Right, so the observation was, you're being too cute here. You could just check to see if n is equal to the size and then set it back equal to zero. And you're certainly right, I could do that.
I don't know if that helps.
It would be one more line of code. And I want to try to fit it on the slide. That's the only reason I did it that way. I'm being really cute here. You're absolutely right. Yeah. There was a question in the back? Yeah. So I could still leave it general if I made n the like a template argument.
Right. I mean, you wouldn't be able to use it.
That's absolutely true. I could make it more efficient that way by making it slightly less flexible at runtime. Yeah.
For the equal.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was going to ask if it's necessary to also compare the ranges itself is the same source. Like, you have two cursors that came from the same source.
So would I need in the equal to compare that the ranges are also the same? And the answer is no, because it's really only valid to compare iterators into the same range. That you can just assume that those are going to be the same. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have a zip rate?
I do have a zip range, yeah.
Because zip is isomorphic with transpose.
Zip is isomorphic with transpose.
You can do a zip and it will transpose. Your range of ranges will become a, instead of an M by N, it will become an M by M range of ranges that's transpose range.
I need to think about that. Okay.
That's where I thought you were going, because I thought you were going to go with zip.
Oh, interesting. I'm really kind of curious to see that solution now. Okay. Yeah, we'll talk with you later. Okay. So maybe this is even smaller than I thought. Okay. But I kind of wanted to show how to build a range using range facade. Yeah. Okay. Oops. So now we use the same trick as we used before with make pipeable, and we build an interleave view the exact same way. And now I can create a range of ranges. This is just some throwaway test code. This is a range 0, 1, 2. And I repeat it 3 times. Print it out, and then print it out interleaved. Here's it before interleaving. Here's it after interleaving. 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2. Cool. Works. And I told you that transpose was just an interleave followed by a chunk, and so there it is. Transpose. I use make pipeable. I forward it to interleave and to chunk, and I've transposed a range of ranges. Here's that same test code, except I use a transpose instead of an interleave now. And now you can see I've transposed the rows and the columns of this range. Yeah? What was the first part of that question?
Why forward iterable and not in iterable?
So the question was, why do I need forward iterable here? So I need forward iterable because I need to know how to chunk it. So I compute the distance of the range. If this were just an input iterable, that would actually consume the range, just computing its distance. And then I can't transpose it anymore. Question.
Well, so that brings up a more general question. There are a couple places where you say, well, you copy views, you can provide iterates twice. So what iterator concepts are required for what functionality? It seems like some things work on input iterable. Some things only work on forward iterable, iterable, and be slow. Otherwise, or they need random access for mass distance computation and so on. So is there some way to know what concept is required for what operations on the ranges?
So the question is, how do you know which operations require which capabilities? And I admit, I don't have great documentation right now. If I did have great documentation, I would say, read the docs. Instead, what I would say is, try it. You will get a concept check failure from the library, and it will say, I needed you to pass me a forward iterable here, and this one's only input.
So it does check concepts. So if you combine view group by and you only have an input iterator, it will complain.
It will complain, yeah. You will get a concept check failure, and it will tell you exactly what the problem is.
One more follow-up. So what if you had a thing that is actually forward iterable, but you didn't tag it with a type trait, will that still fail?
If you had something that was a forward iterable and you didn't tag it with a type trait, you don't tag things with type traits. The concept checks probe for capabilities. It's an emulation of concepts light. So it checks to see what things compile, and then you turn that into compile time Boolean using generalized Sphene for expressions. And then you report the Boolean as a static assert failure. Right. But iterators need an iterator tag type.
That's what I'm saying.
Right.
So if you forgot that, you would complain, and then you have to don't have that.
Yeah, if you forgot to have the tag type, then something that is actually input might look like forward, And it's probably not going to complain at compile time. What you'll get is totally bizarre runtime behavior. Yeah. Yeah. OK, so we have transpose now. Hooray. OK, let's go back and look at where we are. So we got a chunk, we got a transpose, and then we're going to join, print, and then flake out. So I know how to do all of these things already. Yeah, questions?
We were talking about the interleaving and having the chunks to be of the same size.
Mm-hmm.
What if they have 30 months? Do you handle that? You may be handling it, I was asking.
So the question was, so what does the interleave do if the ranges have different lengths?
Yeah, you may end up with 13 months, for example.
Sorry, yeah. Well, OK. No, the in our solution, we have the rows are going to be the months, and the columns are going to be the lines in each month. We already made sure that those are going to be the same, because we added those. Remember when we added padding lines to make them all 7 lines long? So they're all going to have 7 lines. We know they're all going to be exactly the same length. So we don't have to worry about interleave doing something weird for ranges that have different lengths. But if they did, if you were to pass something to interleave that had different lengths, remember there was that call to mismatch? So your iteration is going to stop as soon as one of the ranges reaches the end, which means you're going to drop some elements on the floor, which might not be what you want, but is good enough for our purposes.
Because in this case, you're going to end up with, in a 12-month case, it aligns perfectly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if you have one more month added, it's going to be sitting there at the beginning.
It'll sit there at the bottom. Yeah. Yeah. Matt?
Going back to the concept question,
mm-hmm.
Is there a reason why you assume, you said you forget the trait, it assumes forward. Is there a reason why you forget the trait, you would do the reverse, assume input, rather than the less refined concept or the more refined concept? So that way you get a compiler instead of bizarre behavior.
So the question is, if you forget the trait, then why not just assume that it's input instead of forward? So I think I misspoke. If you forget the trait, then you're not going to model any concept at all. You have to say. And I think that's the correct answer.
Okay, I agree with that.
That's much better.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Did you mean tag when you said trait?
Tag.
Thank you.
Sorry. So like I said, we already know how to do the rest of this stuff, so we can skip to the chase. Here's the final solution. So from the top, we make a range of dates, we group the dates into months, we format the months into a range of strings, we group the months that belong side by side, we transpose, this is new, transpose months, we ungroup the side by side months, and we join the strings of the transposed months. So let's look at transpose months and join months. These are the last little pieces. Transpose months is a transform followed by a transpose. And join months, well, we've already seen this guy, action join. We've got a bunch of strings. We want to join them all together into one big line. OK. That's what we get. All right. So looking again at this solution, the interesting thing to note about this solution is still, we've solved the entire problem. There is not a single loop anywhere in our code. There was exactly one if statement. Our solution is composable. All of this stuff is reusable. It still works with infinite ranges. I can show n months side by side. So I never really had to hard code 3 in here anywhere, right? I can read this as a command line parameter and get 4 months side by side, or 5 months, right? No raw loops. This is correct by construction. One sec. And this is a really important point. If we were to do this, imperative, procedural way, right? If this were our job and we had a day to do it, we'd probably write a bunch of nested for loops, compute a bunch of offsets, write a whole slew of bugs, and spend the rest of our lives trying to work out like how to get this thing to format correctly and end up with something, some software artifact that is not reusable and not general. Right? Here, we did it in a pretty straightforward, mathematical sort of way. We are pretty sure that our solution is right. No reason to think it's wrong. We didn't do anything fancy, right? So, I mean, this is really huge. And this is how I want to see C++ in the future. Like, I really want people to be able to write software like this and to do it with standard components. Out of the box, this is C++ comes with this stuff out of the box. That's what I want. Yeah. So let's talk about standardization. So this is where we are right now. So, oh, sorry, Marshall, you had a question, didn't you?
I had a comment, actually. It yeah. Just comment, but I'm going to take credit for it. Oh. I'm going to hand it first.
Yeah.
You missed an important point on your previous slide.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
What's that?
There's no container of dates there.
Right. So the point is there is no container of dates anywhere. All of this stuff happens lazily and on demand, right? So if I take this thing, right, and I throw it to some algorithm that says, well, actually, I only need like the first 3 months to be formatted, right? I could do that pretty easily, right? I could take these adapters and I could put that in a function, give it a name that says format calendar, right? That can be applied to any range of dates, however long, and it will just keep on spewing formatted calendars. Yeah.
So the code looks really nice, mathematic, beautiful, composable, all that, because you have the make pipe over it. And like, you know, all this composing stuff in the range library, right? It cannot be used in user-defined functions or like if I have a bunch of code, I want to make it like this.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have support in the standard for that.
So none of this stuff is in the standard right now.
Right.
And that's the point. I've written the range library. I'm in the process of making proposals to the standard library. And just gotta turn the crank and wait.
No, my question is the concept of composability. It's part of the range library, but I cannot use that in my library. That's not range.
Okay, so the composability part is part of the range library. Yeah, and the range library is available today. You can download it and use it.
So can I compose my functors and objects and such? And use only the composability part of the range library and not the ranges.
So can you just use makepipeable?
Yes.
Makepipeable is part of the range library. If you want to use makepipeable, then you have to download the range library. I haven't separated that out. Yeah.
Is it usable only with ranges or can it be used with other things?
So makepipeable knows nothing about ranges. The only thing that makepipeable knows about is unary functions, and really that's it. Unary functions and operator pipe, right? It's just a different way of writing function call syntax. That's all it is, perfectly general.
So this is the same concept that I was getting at yesterday at the lightning talks. Yeah. So we need something like this where, you know, the code looks more functional,
mm-hmm.
no loops, all the stuff, right?
Yeah.
All this comes free because it's more functional. And you want, like, more code, more functional.
Yeah, yeah. And you're right. This is a very functional way of doing it. In fact, you'll notice that as we were programming this, there's hardly any state in our program that gets manipulated. So bugs come from state, right? And if there's very little state, there's very little room for bugs. All right. Question?
I'm trying to picture stepping through this with a debugger.
So stepping through this with a debugger, what would it be like? So that's not how you would debug it, I would say. So the interesting thing to note here, this is the copy algorithm. This is a range that you're going to call begin on this range, and you're going to get back some unbelievably complicated iterator type that actually does all of this stuff under the covers. One iterator type that does it all. Yeah. So what would it be like to debug that iterator? No. What you do is you build this up piece by piece, and you test each component as you go. Yeah?
It's worth mentioning that all of these things are separately testable, whereas the nested group solution is not as testable.
So the components, you said, are testable. Like all these little things, like transpose, interleave, chunk, right? All of those things are perfectly general, have nothing to do with dates at all, right? And they are separately testable, right? And once you are sure that all of those components work, then you can be sure that you can snap them together and things are going to continue to work. I said there'll be no bugs in production because I've...
Because you've tested everything, and that's essentially the argument. So basically, you've got a core dump in the middle of this because of some iterator stability issue because you manipulated the container using, you know, an action, and now some other range is invalid even though you thought it was valid. Essentially, you're forced to go through those ridiculous pipes because you've got a core dump that came back from the customer. Now, so I mean, it's, the point is well made, but the debugger issue is still a real issue.
The debugger issue is still a real issue, yes, because you have things like iterator stability, and you have things like object lifetime, and you're absolutely right. I was fudging a bit. There are problems with debugging this code, but I'd say that the alternative is not better. That is trying to write this out as an imperative program with a bunch of nested for loops and offset computations.
Is it possible to write a bunch of GDB macros that help understand those template types and make the debugger better?
So would it be possible to write GDB macros to help make sense of this stuff? That's not my forte. I don't really know. Yeah?
This reminds me of ADL. What you really want is an interpreter that would fix it. It was one by one, let you look into the internal state. And you could debug it that way. That's how you want to debug this.
So the point was, it's like APL. That's out of my domain. But it would be nice if the debugger could give us a little bit of help here. Yeah. I don't know how to do that. Yeah.
I think the point was building this up with a REPL would be really nice.
To build it up with a REPL would be really nice. Yeah, it would. Yeah, agreed. Robert.
There's one thing I think that I did something similar to this many years ago. In my recollection is that the thing could only fail if and only if one of the components failed. And so if you just reran the test, one of your tests had to be wrong if the thing failed. So I ended up spending no time tracing through the debugger, basically trying to just add stuff to test the individual ones until I could get it to fail. Yep. And so the whole dynamic of the kind of work I was doing was different. But it did leave me a feeling of less confidence, I have to say.
Yeah, so the observation was that oftentimes, if your program end-to-end fails, that there's some failure at a very small, on the smaller scale, and then it's just a matter of trying to like augment your tests until you can get that one small component to fail. Yeah. Yeah.
So outside of transpose, are there any copies of the underlying data?
Outside of transpose, so transpose does not copy any data.
It's not copying stuff in those vectors and stuff.
Okay, so you're right. Transpose is copying three ranges at a time into a vector. That's the copy that you make. Those ranges themselves are automatically generating the elements within them. So what other copies are going on here? So when I say action join, I'm actually going to be joining strings. And that's the only other thing that's done eerily and that allocates memory while this is running. Okay. Now I want really quickly to say where we are in the standardization process. So we've got the concepts and the algorithms. I've just proposed these, and I was at the committee meeting last week to talk about it. These other things, in fact, like the view adapters, we built this entire application using view adapters. They haven't been proposed yet. That's on my to-do list. Also, the actions and the facade and the range adapter helpers, I would love to propose those also, but I haven't gotten around to it yet. I do intend to propose them. So here's where we are on the timeline. In October, I made an initial proposal of the ideas. Last week, we did a cursory review of the concepts and the algorithms. In the next 6 months, we're going to be doing a detailed wording review, and then I'm going to see if I can make some other range proposals. I want to talk about infinite ranges. I want to support proxy iterators, and I want to propose some of those range views that were so handy. So maybe in October, we could vote initial wording for the concepts and the algorithms into some sort of draft, maybe call it a ranges TS. And then look at the other proposals, even more range-related proposals, the actions, the facade, and the adapter, you know. And then at some point, the TS will be approved, I don't know when, and at some point, that will be merged into some future version of C++, and I don't know what that would be. But when it does get merged in, it will probably be in a separate namespace. This will probably end up as version 2 of the standard template library. Question?
What about the changes to the range for loop?
Ah, right. So that is in this paper. I proposed that already last week. People have already started looking at it. Yeah. So that's where we are. Here's where you could find out more. This is the paper that I presented in October. This is a very readable, presentable presentation. Here is the detailed wording for the algorithms and the concepts. Not fun evening reading. And here's my range library. It's a C++ 11 implementation. You could use it today. I need to thank a few people, Andrew Sutton and Sean Parent. Those were my co-authors on my October paper. And they contributed a great deal. I'm very thankful for their feedback. And Herb Sutter and the C++ Standardization Foundation, this is now my full-time job. And I can do that because of a grant from the foundation. So I owe them a huge thank you. So thank you. Okay, now we're ready for some questions. Yeah?
So it's a C++ 11 library. Have
so,
there been any situations where you found yourself wanting
C++ 14? So yes, it's a C++ 11 library. Have I wanted C++ 14? So there is some C++ 14 in there, but it's pre-processed. So for instance, there's some constexpr stuff that is only constexpr in C++ 14.
Eric, can you ask people stuff?
Oh, yeah. Sure, sure. If you got questions, come on down to the mic. So that way I don't have to repeat your questions.
I'm curious for your concept macros. What did you use to implement those?
So the concept macros are expressions fine. One of the first things that I did when I started implementing my range library, because I knew I wasn't going to get very far without concepts light, is I built this library that emulates concepts light, and it's done entirely using expressions fine. So you know, I put valid expressions in a sfine context, and either that overload goes away or it doesn't. And you can detect this at compile time and report back true, false. It models the concept or it doesn't. Yeah.
But really, you would want to use Andrew's concepts library if it was available.
Absolutely. I intend to port the whole thing to concepts light. Yeah.
So with your whole thing, I'm assuming that the time complexity is linear with respect to the number of days, But just looking at it, it's hard for me to tell that. So how easy is it to analyze the time complexity when you have all this laziness?
So how, so each component has a certain complexity, right? So all of the views are linear complexity, and they compose in a linear way, right? So like, if you have a big pipeline of linear operations, that whole thing is linear, and it's going to traverse your data exactly once. That's it. This is linear. All of these operations are linear. The algorithms are linear. Some of them traverse twice, you know, like the group by, but it's still linear, right? 2n is still linear.
You mentioned that the group by travels twice. So what is the requirements for the range in your presentation? Forward, input?
What's the requirements on group by?
The highest requirements.
The highest requirements on?
The whole algorithm you just showed.
The requirements on everything that I just showed, I think the input range needs to be forward, and that's it. So we're not using anything besides advance, you know, increment in any of these operations. So any forward range would work. Yeah.
Thinking about interpreters made me realize we have one, Abel Sienkiewicz's shell. Have you tried importing your library into that?
No, I haven't. So Abel has a, this is the template metaprogramming shell?
Yeah, meta shell.
Oh, the meta shell. I think the meta shell would help debug metaprograms, but this isn't exactly a metaprogram. There is some complicated type construction that happens here under the covers, but really the action is taking place at runtime. So how would you debug that at runtime is, I think, the question that some people have. And it is an interesting question.
I'll think about that.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the storage requirements for the views and the actions? Is it two pointers, or is some of them bigger?
Okay, so the storage requirements for the ranges and the actions, the ranges are generally pretty lightweight. They have at most a couple of pointers, most of them. The exception was the interleave view, which, as you saw, had a vector, and the interleave view iterator, which also had a vector. That's kind of an outlier. Most of these ranges are really very small and lightweight. Likewise for the actions, they have no state themselves. They just manipulate the state that's being passed in.
Thank you very much.
Just one more question. Did you get any sense of how large a program this was compared to the old-fashioned way of doing it?
You know, I didn't actually write it like in a procedural sort of way, because I couldn't stand the thought. So I don't know how long the program would be if I wrote it in a procedural way. Probably a little bit longer. I'm just hazarding a guess, but like I said, this was only 150 lines of code. I think you'd have a hard time implementing it procedurally and correctly in that many lines of code, and have anything near as reusable as what this is.
In terms of executable instead, as opposed to source code.
So executable size. You're talking about size. I have no idea. Yeah, I don't know. I didn't even look at the executable size. Yeah. Okay, thanks, guys.